So I wanted to talk about Debian auto building because there were some changes since last DebConf, at least with relation to the maintenance. I'm glad that there are at least some people in here. Didn't expect that to happen actually, and people told me that they won't come because they need sleep. So, well, between last DebConf and now, we had some changes in who maintains the wanna-build infrastructure, which had a bit to do with communication with some people who've done it before. And thanks to the DPL and, well, the old maintainers, we've got new people involved to maintain it. So the current set of people who are actually in the group are Luke, Dato, Mark Brockschmidt, Andreas Barth, and me, and Kurt Rex recently joined, like yesterday or the day before. So there are also new people joining, which is great. And we also have Roger Leith, who maintains S-Build and Build-D, and who's very responsive, although he does very much refactoring on the software, which is why we don't currently run the same version as an unstable, but yeah. In short, what did happen since then? We had some additions of new architectures, like recently K3BSD into variants. We moved, well, one architecture away, which is M68K. And we were even asked to re-add an architecture, which is the Herd. I don't know if they, well, they claim they are working actively on it. They are still in unstable in the official archive. So it makes some sense to re-add it. It was all pretty easy, especially the K3BSD one. It was very nice to work with the porters to do it. They made sure that the software runs on their system, of course, which is SCH root, which needed some adjustments. And yeah, so that's fine. But the main point is that we are currently still trying, because it's a not that easy action, to synchronize the software on the build daemons. Historically, every build daemon runs some, well, version the build daemon maintainer acquired at some point, which was either from the public SVN or some customized beta version that was not ready for public release, which is nice because it's actually running in production, but it's not ready to be released to the public. And now we're trying to get everything onto the unstable S-build, which makes it easier for people to actually test with S-build, because there might be some problems interacting with S-build. We are currently trying to figure out what the heck happens with Octave, which only seems to fail under S-build. But yeah, it's better to have an unstable version that people can actually fetch and install, and people are actually doing that and not only using pbuilder. And we are also trying to sync build-d, and that also works on a now large set of build daemons, but not all are converted yet, simply due to the fact that there are functional differences between the two versions. And we branched off the old public version, and there were some feature additions in the non-public version which are not yet synced, but we are hoping to get that done soon. And well, we didn't do much work yet on the server side, to be honest. It's still a mess with Perl hashes in BDB databases, which means that there is no sane concurrent access. And we have nice things like Shroon's PHP build-d states overview pages, which most people use, but that's only synced every 15 minutes because it needs to put it from one BDB database into another BDB database format that PHP can actually read. So we're trying to solve this by moving to Postgres at some point, and Roger Leith is actively working on it. But I don't know when it will be ready. So currently we are still dealing with people in Unix groups to get write permissions, which is in itself fine, but you get nice things when you're trying to do transactions. Thankfully enough, we got transaction support done by Joachim Breitner, more or less in the last few days, which is basically copying over the databases, locking them, and doing stuff, which is actually needed because there is no sane way to say, I do need a binary NMU, which the release team does very often, and I want to set a dep rate at the same time. So there's an inherent race condition if you set an NMU or schedule an NMU and don't put in a dep rate, because in this time the build can actually fetch the new build record and starting building, and then it's for nothing because it just dep rated afterwards anyway. We also try to be a bit more public, which means we got a BTS pseudo package to assign bugs to, which is mainly used by us to do some tracking of what still needs to be done. There's a new public list now instead of the older mail contacts. Debian W team at listdebian.org, so it's also archived if people want to read up discussions. And now there's a hash missing. We also got an IRC channel, which is quite active, which might also be a bit bad because, well, it's not archived publicly and we are discussing quite some stuff there. Yeah. That's mainly to show who's currently involved. So we still have every architecture maintained by different people, which makes sane if they are actively involved in the part in question. And also because it's some work to keep a build running. Wouter posted it to his blog some days ago. And well, keeping the change routes up to date and similar stuff takes time, and keeping up with the failed logs. So, well, there are some architectures that are, well, let's say redundant in some way. There are other architectures where we currently don't have the opportunity to keep up with people not signing for a week, which could easily happen on some architectures. So basically we need to wait at this point if we don't know where the person disappeared to without telling us beforehand. But, well, currently it works okay-ish. So, yeah, that's also count of buildies. I listed Debian.org machines and non-Debian.org machines simply because we want to move, I hope to have that earlier on the slides, to move them into DSA-maintained machines to have control of the infrastructure, which is currently a bit a strange thing because we're dependent on some build maintainers which don't give us access to the machines, and then even if the machines themselves are donated to Debian. So we're just trying to get the same set of policies onto the machines, the same set of software, and it greatly helps to have the help of DSA to get that done. Well, we will take care of AMD64 in one way or another. DSA told us they have plenty of such machines, which I guess is true with KVM domains and stuff. There are still ARM boxes to DSA, well, mainly to ship them to other hosting locations because they are behind NATs, which is not, which DSA doesn't like. The situation for ARMEL is similar because the non-Debian boxes are mainly some development boards that are blazingly fast but hosted somewhere at home. But at least we have got for Debian.org boxes, which is, well, some kind of redundancy, and it would be enough to run stable, of course, on them, and security, maybe not keeping up with unstable, but we will work on that too. HPPA is a topic that's a bit difficult because people sometimes seem to care about that part, but sometimes do not. Well, actually, whenever you ask the mailing list, they want to be to stay in, included, but they only well, the last news they said is they are not interested in doing a release, just being an unstable, which makes it hard if you have stable build these and the one of two, one or two, well, those are more or less identical machines. One of them is very crashy. I think the other one is currently stable. Those all seem to be kernel issues. We had random segmentation faults on them, which make building very hard because, well, it's like make sec faulting and you just can give the build back and you don't know what happened. And we're currently even running one unstable build on the Porter box simply to keep up with unstable when one of the normal build goes away. So we need to solve that one or another soon. But dropping an architecture is not really our call. And there are, well, K3BSD, which is on the lowest, I don't know if one can see that. And that's being worked on to move it onto DSA. It's just that there's currently no installation media to do it in a sane way. So that's currently pending, but being worked on. And there's S390, which is difficult to deal with. I don't know what happens with that if we get access to build these to actually do building on Debian at all costs. And well, with the exception of ARM mainly, and MIPS, two are usually enough to on reasonably fast architectures. So with one box building and one box of redundancy, like on AMD64, it's perfectly fine. And at least for the current amount, if you integrate experimental, it could need some additions, but we don't know yet. Okay, there were also some maintenance changes on the file packages arc specific. That file, which I want to show, it's not everybody knows this file, I have the feeling. So if you have a package that doesn't build on all supported architectures and are not able to just deprecate on a package they need, like if you're having a mono package which just needs mono to be available, which can be solved by a deprecate, you should get the package added to this file, at least currently, and because the reason is that the package source used to put just arc any into the DSC when there was an architecture, well, if there's a different set of architectures when you look at the binary packages, which means even if there are like an architecture all package and then one binary package with just three architectures or something, it told you any and then it tried to build on every architecture that we have, because Vanderbilt simply didn't have the information to do excluding. And that's why packages arc specific was originally created. Now the package source is a bit more intelligent, but it's hard to tell if it's really done by the new dpackage because the source format, or well, some version numbers didn't change. Yeah, we will see if that continues this way. Mainly what it does is if a record is present, which can be either positive, listing all architectures, or like here negative to exclude just one architecture. Or maybe the better example is XORG, which is excluded with every single package. They need to be added there. Okay. So those need manual changes, and the way we want them to be is that you open a bug against build.debian.org. Actually, it's written on the top of the file what to do, but it's still requests are still coming through various media, so we want to standardize on the BTS to do it, to keep track of changes and to have people commenting on changes if they are not sane or something. There is also integration of packages ARC specific into the build the overview pages, at least some of them. They are currently sadly out of date, mainly because they are still pulling from the CVS, I think, and did annotation about who did the change, and that's not, well, it's possible with JIT, but nobody bothered yet to convert it. It should be easy, though, to just point it at a new file, and then you don't get revision information, but I mean, well. Well, for completeness, I also listed the URLs, but I think it should be Googleable. So in the course of introducing new lists, the contact addresses for some points changed a bit. For bin NMUs, it used to be Debian release, and it still is, mainly because when you need bin NMUs, it's about transitions, mostly, unless you fix up some quirks in like libc6, because dpkgdev was a bit strange. And the release team needs to be on top of that. But if you have giveback requests that are covering like the whole set of architectures because the package failed to build on all architectures or something, the best way is to contact Debian W team, and we will tend to it. Mostly the same for dependency rates. There are differing opinions, though, if the build the maintainers should instead do them. But because there are varying levels of build the maintenance, it's hard to generalize. And I think the most sane bit, mostly because dependency rates affect multiple architectures, is just to contact Debian W team. If it's about the software, where we are running, well, almost unstable as build, but not yet. Well, I think Roger actually uploaded a build to unstable, but nobody tried that version because it's not the version we actually use on the build-ts. We are still taking care of build somehow, but if you want improvements in as build, that list build, the tools devlet, oh, that one is wrong. At least alias debian.org is the right place to ask, and well, or file a bug against sbuild, and it will eventually pop up on the official auto builders. Or maybe quicker if you ping us with a patch. We are currently maintaining a separate branch in the repository of our software, so it's all public. It's a buildy branch in the sbuild repository. Okay, and there's also the architecture aliases on build.debian.org, where you reach the set of maintainers I mentioned earlier. In fact, I composed that list from the mail aliases file. And if you have problems with specific buildies or specific architectures, if your package was built but somehow somehow managed to vanish, or didn't get a log, which is currently, sadly, more often the case on one PowerPC auto builder than it should be. Mine. Mainly because the mirror is botched and sbuild can't deal with the thing that they are doing extensive caching, and we have a mismatch of the packages files versus the other files. And then you can ask us, because the point is the WNW team currently doesn't have access to the buildies, which is somehow taken care of. There was a recent introduction of a new group to have access to have at least login access to the buildies, but it of course turns out that if you are not in the right Unix group, you can't read stuff, so it doesn't actually help on some buildies. Yeah, architecture specific givebacks are already mentioned, I think, so. We also changed the format of requests a bit, which is mainly because the wanna build native format is a bit cumbersome. Dato wrote a wrapper, which somebody might of you might have seen if they are following release or WNW team, which is convenient because you can do stuff like specifying which architecture should be taken care of, even with excludes, in the same way. Otherwise, you would have to spell it out like wanna build, I need that build database from that architecture multiple times because you want to cover all architectures. And well, the format is actually, if you do an NMU, you say NMU, you say source package underscore version, which is a pretty common format for wanna build, the set of architectures and the reason. It's not that you actually need to do this if you request bin NMUs, we will take care of it, but if it's mass NMUing because you're doing some transition for programming languages that need bin NMUing every time they get a new compiler or something, it really helps if we get a set of NMUs and appropriate dep rates. So for dep rates it's similar. There's even an example of the epoch which we use in that wrapper, and there the message is actually what we want to dep rate on. If you are more interested in that, you can look at the source of the tool, which is available in the release tools JIT. I don't know if it's linked from there. Doesn't seem to be that way. Or just ask on the list, so we can give you pointers about how to do it. It's just more convenient for us, but it's not a precondition to do so. Then I wanted to talk a bit about auto-signing, which is flowing a bit around as a proposal since the Extremadura QA meeting. What we want to achieve with that is a faster turnaround for package builds, which means that we can clear dep rates faster, which is especially interesting if you have a long chain of dep rates with multiple levels, which is often the case with packages that languages that need massive bin NMUing like OCaml and Haskell. It speeds up transitions because like if you provide a fix for a bug, you get your upload instantly if you want to get a transition done. It speeds up like the OCaml transition because actually it doesn't take that long to get all the builds done, which needs currently more iterations from building the package, the buildy maintainer signing the log, the buildy automatically uploading it, installing it into the archive, and then clearing a dep rate, and then start building, waiting for the buildy maintainer. So it can take several days, or if people only sign three times a week, it can take much longer, which it shouldn't need to. Of course, we still have the default H days of 10 on uploads, but well, if you have a transition almost ready and only waiting for some last fixes, it would be convenient. We propose it to do it for packages with priority optional and extra, which means that packages with a higher priority still get review. This was actually, I think, proposed by FTP masters to do it like this. Yeah, it's still not set in stone, the whole proposal, and I'm very open for input if people have concerns or proposals. And so other packages should still get checked, and of course failed logs get mailed as usual, so the only thing that goes away are successful build logs for optional and extra, which is the majority of the build logs you actually get. And which people don't actually check that much that they may be used to do. So it's not that if you sign a log, you're looking through all the logs from beginning to the bottom. You can do some regular expressions, but I don't think we suffer that much from doing that because we have to trust the build D anyway because it does the building, and if the root is somehow dirty with bad stuff, we get screwed anyway. There are some preconditions we want to have to do implement auto-signing, which the first of one is a DSA maintained build D, which has the reason, okay, we have control over it. And it's included in the usual monitoring checks by DSA, temper checks if some people played with binaries on the host or something. And what FTP master also wants to see is that it's not possible to download some malicious code from the internet, which is of course sane because it would, because it also affects the reproducibility of the build. So we will limit at least inbound traffic for the normal build process. I don't know if outbound traffic could also be filled. Yeah, well, it can, but I don't know if that's really a concern. And the machine needs to be restricted. So it won't probably don't be on a Porter box. So the point was that we should also limit outbound traffic because we don't allow this anyway. That's true, but currently every build D has got, in the Debian archive, has got internet access. So all the failure to builds were actually discovered by Lucas in his script rebuild.
Well, that may be true now, but it wasn't always true. There have been cases where outbound traffic was, for instance, going over a very, very slow line.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Sure. Well, we don't want it to interfere, and I think if you limit inbound traffic, you can't produce outbound traffic. Well, theoretically you can, but...
True.
There are also some practical considerations about how to do a signing, and it was proposed to do GPG keys on the build Ds that are actually subkeys and are rotated. The proposal of the FGP masters involved rotating every 3 months, which may be a bit often, but that's still to be determined, and we will eventually work something out. The current state is also that they will need to be passphrase-less simply because it's not possible yet, I think, to query GPG agent if a key is actually unlocked, because the protocol doesn't support it. So if anybody knows something about GPG agent and if this is actually possible.
I think so. I do think that's actually one of the other reasons why I'm not very fond of auto-signing, because you need to have a very gaping security hole in the build daemon. Well, everyone who can get in there without leaving any traces has a key to upload packages to the archive. And nobody will know.
Well, the point is to have a restricted upload queue that only accepts build from the build these IPs.
That would mitigate that somewhat, yeah, indeed.
Of course, you can still upload from, I don't know, project machines or from build these. I don't know how the restriction will be done, especially with dynamic IPs, to upload them to some sort of jump host or something. Yeah, of course, that's a concern, but we want to rotate them often enough. And we currently already have some sort of issue with the successful build log, with the path it takes from the build D to the build D maintainer, which isn't entirely secure.
That's true.
And if you don't watch, I mean, I have appropriate checks in place that it doesn't get sent anywhere. That's not build D, but I don't know about the policies of other people.
As far as I know, there are no.
No policies. Yeah, right. Well, Dato posted it at some point to some bist. And the keys should actually be architecture limited and I didn't write that, and should not be able to upload source packages. So the most you can do is upload a malicious binary for one architecture, which is of course, well, it can have an impact if you get AMD64, i386, for example, it can get very bad, but I think that should limit the exposure quite a bit. Okay, and I'm almost done with what I wanted to talk about before asking questions. But I wanted to say what's next. We currently have to move away from rough Debian.org because it's shipped to another hosting location and it can be down from one day to the other if HP decides to actually move the machines. So we should do that within the next 1 or 2 weeks. DSA doesn't know when the move will happen. We really want to integrate the unofficial auto builders into the Debian.org setup, which is a bit of a pain because people are uploading packages into experimental that aren't actually buildable or something. At least the unofficial infrastructure, it doesn't make very much sense to really care about the build failures because they are so diverse and you don't have a consistent set of packages and, well, and even to do the same with volatile, and I don't know what the state will be with backports because I don't know if it will be integrated into official infrastructure. I think it's planned, but I don't know. Further putting builds under DSA's control, which affects ARM and S390. Further bringing the software in sync, like installing it on the remaining Debian.org machines, for example, which get pushed by Puppet whenever there's a new version available in our archive, and pull wanna build onto a sane database that's actually queryable. I mean, there is actually a script running from cron that exports all the wanna build data and imports it into a Postgres database, which is then in turn used by release tools to determine what transitions need caring, but that's obviously not a solution for the future. Okay, so questions and comments? Anyone?
Well, it's just an idea of something that would be useful to me maybe later. It's somewhat related to the recent problem that we had with the bad symbol files. It would be interesting if we could log somewhere in Buildy when each package log or keep it in a database or something that could be easily integrated in UDD, so that we can query which package have been rebuilt on which arch between two specific dates, for example. And in the same spirit, it would be also interesting to be able to know the set of packages that has been rebuilt with this specific version of DPKG dev or stuff like that, because.
Yeah, sure. The recurrent problem with that is that the transaction log that's produced by WannaBuild contains security-related changes, so we can't just open that up.
Well, WannaBuild does keep a state change data
in
its database.
Yeah, that's a transactions log.
Yeah, okay.
So it's called that way, but it's not a transaction. So
you should be able to use that to figure out what's going on. But if indeed the security is also, it's not stored in there. It's on a per suite basis that trend.
No, it's not.
Oh boy.
Of course, it can be filtered and opened up in some way. If you really are interested in doing that, it shouldn't be much of a problem to generate a crunch. To do a crunch up that just filters the transactions log and puts it into /stats, and then fetching it from there. It's not a really nice solution, of course, but that's what we get currently, and it wouldn't be a problem with Postgres because we get our state changes tracked there.
But wouldn't it be enough to simply have the list of installed packages in the build log? So you can just grab the build log for.
Well, yeah, of course, all information is there. You just have to do the data mining. I mean, we all have all the logs, of course, and
no, we don't have the list of installed packages in the root.
Just one point: having it in the logs is good, but we don't upload logs for the what maintainer they've uploaded, so we don't have whole build logs.
It depends on the version of SBuild you're using, but recent versions, well, some recent versions of some branches, it's a mess, will actually tell you, at least for the toolchain packages, which versions are installed. Yeah. Not everything, of course, that's true, but at least the toolchains.
Okay, there's, of course, the point that you can have packages installed that are not toolchain and do not appear in the build log, that's true.
Right.
But that could be added easily to SBuild to produce the package output of what's currently installed if you need that, which, yeah.
Somehow I have a wish it's bug in dpkg dev that requests to include that information in the change, either in the change file or in the log. Could it be that we find a way later to upload the logs of the, well, together with the source, the logs of the maintainer?
Well, the point is to discard the binary and rebuild it.
Yes, okay.
And then we take care of that automatically. We don't get source-only uploads, but we will eventually get the binary discarded before after FTP master applied some lint checks on it.
Okay, that would solve the concern, yeah. Yes, right.
Something else. There's often problems about outdated build root, or slightly outdated build root, or unclean build root. Have you considered using LVM snapshots? Because the package SBuild does that using SRoot.
Considered? Yes. Actually, getting it implemented is something that involves DSA. Because the hosts currently don't have LVM setups, and I don't know the current position of DSA with relation to LVM on buildies. And you can, of course, have the point that your snapshot is actually exhausted, well, full, if you don't make it big enough.
And it also doesn't solve the problem, because then you just move it to having to update the shoot to having to update the LVM snapshot. Thing where you base yourself.
Yeah,
from.
But you don't get it unclean. That's like
that's true,
a tar.gset you unpack every time.
That's right. But it's, I mean, it's still there's still work to be done, and it's not actually solving the problem.
Well,
plus you add a lot more work for the build daemon, which would have to update a specific package every time as opposed to just once when.
While that's true, that should only be a problem on IO constrained buildies.
That's true. But it's still there.
Yeah, and IO constrained buildies are actually in use on RML, which
wow.
Has well, the development boards are actually fast, I think, but the IO is bad. So well, theoretically one could do unpack like one common state and upgrade it every time, but of course it would do IO churn, but would actually solve the problem, except for the fact that sometimes you break your environment.
It also makes it easier for an architecture to be in trouble if it doesn't have enough build daemons, because it needs to do more between every build. It's wasting more time, which is shouldn't be a problem in the usual case, but when it is a problem, then you suddenly need new hardware sooner.
Yeah, sure. But, well, on the fast arc, it's some kind of trade-off. I mean, on some true. Architectures, it's no problem at all. They are mostly idle anyway, like 90% of the time they are idle. And on other architectures, the slow ones, there's so a huge gap. I think we could handle them differently if we want to. I don't know if it solves the general case. I mean, if we then we still have the problems, then just only on a limited set of architectures, and the other ones would we build it anyway in a quick fashion.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know where we are time-wise. Probably well ahead, but
15 minutes according to my watch.
Just saw something in the back. Okay, so nothing left. You want to ask? comment upon. Wookie?
What about automating Lintian checks at the end of builds or
we won't do that at the end of the build. That's, in my opinion, it should be done on FTP master, and that's because otherwise you have differing checks between buildies. Some buildies maybe do it, some don't do it. It also depends on if you allow maintainer uploads or not, if maintainer are doing Lintian checks on their packages. So I think it should just be done on FTP master. I don't see the point of doing Lintian checks at the buildie, which takes IO and takes time, and don't see why. Wookie wanted to ask something.
This is kind of a little bit off topic, really, but I've got a rather crappy build D for cross-building things, and I guess the question really is, who's the best person to talk to work out how to make the WannaBuild system actually understand how to cross things?
Well, WannaBuild itself should just work because you feed it sources and packages files.
Exactly, it's the sort of scriptifying part, that the S-build part, I guess, that needs to.
And then you should talk to Roger Leith.
Sorry, who?
I don't know how to pronounce the.
Ah, right, okay.
Sorry. Who's the S-build maintainer? You can file a bug. He is pretty responsive, so I think you can work something out.
Cheers.
So.
Just one question. There's been some talk in implementing DDEB support in Debian. Do you know if there's any plan, or the plans of implementing that in SBuild and such on the buildees?
It doesn't affect it. That's my stance on it. Because the actual proposal is to add DDEBs to the changes files, to add DDEBs to the normal build process, so it doesn't affect the buildees. You don't need extra support in SBuild. Because it's just done in unstable for every package. Well, I don't know what if it will be implemented this way, because it blocks probably on other people. But my take on it is that you don't need extra support because you don't put them somewhere differently, and you can just handle it on FTP master if it comes in and move it somewhere else if you don't have enough space on FTP master or something. So that should just work if a version of whatever toolchain package is responsible for doing it, I think. Deb Helper, possibly. Yeah, I know. Does it, then it gets included in the changes and we're done. Well, no.
If you get rid of the binary packages the maintainer uploads, do you get rid also of architectural packages?
We could. Well, we don't know how good we are able to auto-build architecture all packages, but it would be no problem to just assign it to one build D. Well, especially in the case you're rebuilding every anyway, you can just say, like on i386, also build an architecture all package. Of course, it gets a bit hairy if you have, you need to implement architecture affinity, because some architecture all packages actually need to be built somewhere else, like on Spark or PowerPC. I don't know, there was some firmware thing that has it. And we don't know if it affects the content of the architecture all package if you build it on different architectures, but those are bugs anyway, so we need to find them at some point. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for coming, despite breakfast.